One word can make all the difference to the significance of an object. Provenance. In today's show, we meet people with unimpeachable proof of authenticity, direct descendants of those who made or owned the pieces. And there are some pretty special names coming up on Priceless Antiques Roadshow. You may not think it, but sometimes the combined genius of the entire roadshow team of experts is outfoxed by an object.
Well, look,
do you think it has a culinary use?
No.
Frankly, I don't really know. But tell you what we will do, let's go and ask somebody else.
Oh, it's one of these. It's one of these.
What?
Yes.
What do you mean, it's one of these?
I've never seen this before in my life.
Furniture specialist Lennox Cato takes us back to his childhood in Brighton, where his passion for collecting began.
As I was growing up, the lanes, they were unique because there was an antique dealer in every other shop. It was special.
And keeping it within the family, following the DNA of an heirloom.
So you're a direct descendant of Jane Austen?
Wow, she's my great-great-great-grandfather's sister.
Fantastic.
Very often at an antiques roadshow, you'll see a group of specialists scratching their heads over the identity or purpose of some baffling object. And very occasionally, they have to concede defeat, and that object goes down in roadshow legend. Well, here are some honourable members of that exclusive club.
When we watch the Antiques Roadshow, and that includes me, you're somewhat in awe of the knowledge of the experts. You know, the fact that they can pick something up and tell you when it was made, where, by whom, for what purpose, and how much it's worth. And I'm still staggered by their knowledge. But occasionally, things turn up, and they don't actually know what it is.
Well, I tell you what, they would have bought...
Come to me. First of all, you rack your brains yourself to think if you can work out what it is. Then you show whoever you might be sharing the table with, your other experts, and if they don't know either, then the fun starts and you start taking it round all the various experts until you either come up with the right answer or...
My colleagues, because if you don't know, you've got this great think tank around you and you can pass things around. And, I mean, collectively, we've got, you know, several hundred years of experience. So if they don't know, it's often mission impossible.
Not being able to identify the next mystery object really bothered former specialist Tim Wannacott.
It had an ivory handle and then it had an articulated top, which sort of flopped about a bit.
I can't find out what it is. I'm hoping you will tell me.
Well, it's nickel plate, this device, this articulated device on the end. And there's a very indistinct little stamp that says Meyer and Meltzer, which to me would indicate not a cutlery maker necessarily, but more of a medical instrument type man.
So?
Yeah, but they did some pretty peculiar things with some of these instruments as to where they stuck them and what they got up to with them. But frankly, I don't really know. But to what we will do, let's go and ask somebody else.
And then there's a kind of competition between the experts. You know, it's shown from one to the other to the next one.
Are you cleaning something? Pulling something through?
What's something through the what?
I don't know.
And they all give an opinion, and very often, fundamentally disagree with each other.
So what would you do with that?
Well, say you've got a crab claw, and you were trying to force a bit of crab meat out of a crab claw. Might you not use that droopy thing on the end?
You would use it once, and then a bit of crab claw would get stuck in there.
Yes.
It would get salmonella, and the next time you had the crab claw, you'd be dead.
Oh, it's one of these. It's one of these.
What?
Yes.
What do you mean, it's one of these?
I've never seen this before in my life.
I think it's for making holes in roast lamb, for slotting in a garlic clove.
Extracting gunk out of your ear.
Still no answers?
No definite answer, but a lot of food for thought.
Definitely.
And a few weeks later, all became clear. There were lots of letters written in saying, we know what it is. And one of the best was from, I think he was the curator of the collection of the Royal College of Surgeons, who said, of course, this is what it is. It was actually a tracheotomy instrument. And he came with the missing bits.
And this was used as what is called a pilot in order to penetrate an incision which was made in the neck when patients were suffocating to death. And this would relieve their breathing.
So that would be introduced with this blunt end on it so that you could make an easy passage.
Yes.
Then that, presumably that guide would then be withdrawn.
Yes.
And then the patient could breathe through the tube.
Yes.
Had we had the other bits there, we wouldn't have been flummoxed at all, she says confidently.
Sometimes a mystery object can take years to reveal its secrets.
They have no idea what it is, have they?
Not a clue, no.
I remember we were in Oldham in Lancashire once and a lady came in with an object. It was a little bit of a puzzle, really, but no one could exactly identify it.
Someone picked it up on the junk stall and brought it to me and asked me if I was interested because they know I collect ivories. And I said, yes, I'm very interested. What is it? So they said, I haven't a clue. So I thought, right, I will bring it here and ask anyone here if they would know what it was.
20 years later, we were in Oldham again, and again the same lady turned up, this time telling us what she thought it was.
This is an interesting little bit of roadshow history. There's Arthur, of course. This is you, 20 years ago, on our last visit to Oldham. And I'm playing Angela Rippon.
You remember the occasion, do you?
Oh, I do, because they had not a clue what it was, you see.
And you've still got it, and nobody knew what it was.
No.
And did you ever find out?
Yes.
What is it?
It's used by elderly Chinese ladies to pass on their leisure hours. It is a Chinese puzzle.
Wonderful.
Like the old cat's cradle.
Oh, the cat's cradle.
Oh, yes, yes.
In other words, she'd spent 20 years after the first roadshow doing her research.
You see, if at first you don't succeed, someone somewhere will come up with an answer. Now, in this series, we're asking our specialists to nominate an all-time favourite roadshow find, the piece that stands out from the rest. For Hilary Kay, there was no mystery the day in Scarborough. A very rare set came her way.
The Scrimshaw work was very important. I mean, the fact that they were on a carving knife and fork was neither here nor there. It was the actual, the handles themselves, those sperm whale teeth that had been carved, which were very important.
Before I came up to Scarborough, I thought to myself, wouldn't it be nice, because of its associations with whaling historically, wouldn't it be great if there were some whaling things that came in? And you've answered my dream. Thank you. Now tell me how you got hold of them.
Well, they've been in the family since the 1820s, and they've been passed down each to the eldest son of each generation. My father was the last crowder, as there were mainly girls in the family.
Yes.
And so they were then passed down to me.
Do you like them?
I do, very much, yes.
Yes, I think they're fabulous.
The depiction of the ship Elizabeth was beautifully done. Not only did it show the ship itself, but it showed a whale tied up to the side of the ship. It was beautifully inscribed.
And on the back, there is a representation of a whale hunt in operation.
Every single quality that a top American Scrimshaw collector would look for.
I'm almost certain that it's the work of somebody called Edward Burdett, who was a very important person in the history of Scrimshaw.
The importance of Edward Burdett as a Scrimshaw artist really can't be overrated, because he is one of the very first that is properly documented, and his work is instantly recognisable and widely collected as that particular artist.
His style is very distinctive, and although these aren't signed, they're recognisable. They're instantly recognisable as his work. And I would have said we're talking between £10,000 and £15,000.
Gosh, much sad.
Yes.
And very sensibly, the owner decided not to keep it and sent it to America eventually for sale, where it went for $61,000.
$61,000 to sell or not to sell? No contest. Now, we're taking this chance to show you behind the scenes with some of the members of our team to understand more about how they acquire their specialist knowledge. Furniture expert Lennox Cato has been with us on the roadshow for 5 years now.
The main wood is rosewood.
Oh, yes.
And even though you use it for, you know, your suppers and things like that, it's really a breakfast table.
Oh, really?
But he first cut his teeth in the trade during the swinging 60s in Brighton.
As I was growing up, the lanes, they were unique because there was an antique dealer in every other shop. Say, ceramics, furniture, pictures, brass, clocks. It was special. Now, as you know, as we wander around, they've all gone. My grandparents, they had a number of shops. I think they had 11. On my mother's side, they had shops in the lanes. They were furniture makers. And so my brother, now Lincoln, has become more of a furniture maker. Hi.
How are you? Nice to see you.
Well, you too. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. Let's have a wander around Brighton. So I wonder what all these shops would have been.
Oh, I think they were more antique shops, to be perfectly honest. Antiques were big things in those days.
My brother and I were both adopted when we were very young, and our adopted parents were antique dealers, so we grew up in the antique trade. Then, you know, when we lived in Brighton, it was when dealing really happened. My father, his name was, they called him Dickie Compton. He was a bit of a character. He always wore a hat and used to wear like a Cossack hat. He would take us around to different shops. You could walk into one shop and buy something and walk 50 yards and sell it to another dealer and earn yourself 10 or 20 pounds. At the end of the day, the more dealing you could do, the more money you would earn. And I used to work in his shop after school, tidying things up. With the dealers in the lane, especially the what I would call the old school, dealers just love to talk. And when they've got time on their hands, they're not doing any business, they will start reminiscing and just tell you stories. They will test you, do you know what that is, son? And you'll say, is it so-and-so? Oh, no. And you'd pick up knowledge from them. Started dealing, really, earliest recognitions when I was at school. I used to do the paper round, and I remember going to school and this particular house, just before you walked into the area of the school, they had this clock in the window. And that particular clock is called a skeleton clock, and they were very, very popular, quite valuable. So I put a note through the door, and lo and behold, they got in contact, and I ended up buying this clock. And I was 14 or 15. It was cheeky, but it's showing an entrepreneurial spirit, and that's what you have to have. I mean, if you're intimidated or afraid, you're not going to go forward. People want to see enthusiasm and drive in all works of business.
And it wasn't long before Lennox opened his first antique shop at just 18.
They're coming to see my little shop here. Oh, it's incredible. It's a burger bar. Look at the size of it. Look at it.
Lovely shop. What sort of things were you selling in those days then?
Pretty much what I was selling now, but obviously different quality. I was, yeah, tables and chairs and
but
general
more smalls,
furniture.
I suppose.
Yeah, a few more smalls.
It was a start anyway then.
Yeah, it was a start. Anyway, do you fancy a burger in there, or should we leave it? You know, when I was a kid, I used to watch the roadshow, and I had no idea that I'd ever be one of those specialists there. I mean, we have a vision and a dream. That was never a part of it. So, yeah, I feel very honoured and great to be part of the team.
Lennox Cato there on a trip down memory lane. Now back to that word, provenance. Proving an object's direct link to a maker or a famous former owner can make all the difference as to whether it makes a million or just a few pounds. Nailing once and for all those important connections is a vital part of our experts' work. And it's a game they love playing at the Antiques Roadshow.
One of the nice things about the Roadshow is that you see things for the first time quite often.
No academic and the market, for certainly, has never seen it. And you're seeing it for the first time. And that's really exciting because it's a little discovery all on its own.
When we hear that it's a family heirloom, it gives immediate context, not only to the person sitting beside you who's brought it, but it also gives context to patronage and to ownership, and it puts the present generation in touch with the one before.
Who made it?
Well, as far as I can gather, my great-great-grandfather.
The word is provenance. It's a French word, and what it means is, where a thing's been all its life. And it's very, very important, because if you assert that something is by somebody, and then you say, well, we can be sure that it is, because although my family has always said so, we go right back to the artist. You know, he was my great-great-great-grandfather, or something like that. And then you've got to take it very seriously. It has the strong sense that it's true.
Well, this is a most impressive-looking family tree. Is it your own?
Yes, it is.
And I see it starts with Edward Austin, who took the name of Knight. Who was he?
Edward Austin was Jane Austen's brother.
The Jane Austen?
The Jane Austen. And he changed his name to Knight when he inherited the Chawton and Godmersham estate.
So you're a direct descendant of Jane Austen?
Yes.
Wow.
She's my great-great-great-grandfather's sister.
Fantastic.
Jane Austen, that's a very interesting case in point. She was an intensely private person. Only 5% of her correspondence survives. And people are hungry for the slightest shred of information about her.
Now, tell me about this.
Well, that is Jane Austen's cup and ball. That is her own cup and ball.
How astonishing. And is it recorded that she played with it?
Yes, it is. Yes, it was. She's well known as spending hours with her cup and ball. She could do over 100 in the cup. But it's one of the things she used to enjoy doing.
Of course, you can't put it to forensic test. There's no DNA that you can test that cup and the ball for to see whether it's got traces of Jane Austen on it. But the way he told the story and the conviction he had, to me, I thought, you know, that man is certainly convinced, but more to the point, he's convincing.
If that came up on the market and was accepted by potential buyers as definitely being Jane Austen's, I would expect that to fetch something in the region of £20,000 to £25,000. It is literary history, no more, no less. It's been a complete joy to see it. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.
That man is certainly convinced, and Paul Viney obviously thought so, because he put quite a large estimate on that thing. And I wouldn't be surprised if he's absolutely right.
Although a famous family connection can push an item's value up, sometimes, even if the creator is unknown, the craftsmanship can speak for itself.
It's a fantastic collection of arts and crafts, silver and jewellery. Who made it?
My great-aunt, Bertha Gough.
And where was she trained?
At the Holloway School of Art in London and later at the Camden School of Art.
She's a name that hasn't come quite to the forefront, probably will on the evidence of this work. We're more used to names like Henry Wilson and Ashby and Liberty indeed, and you see accents in the work here that are a lot to do with all of that.
Well, the extraordinary thing about the collection of jewellery and metalwork made by Bertha Gough was that it had a resonance from William Morris. He would have loved it. It was made by hand. It was made by an individual who honoured craftsmanship above intrinsic value. And it was lovely to find it as an archive, really. It was not only the jewellery, but the drawings and the descendant.
Although these things look, in a sense, art nouveau, in a sense, arts and crafts, they are revivalist. I mean, they draw on 16th and 17th century prototypes, these angels here. Are Renaissance angels, and here is the most marvellous figure of Aphrodite against a blue sky, an Art Nouveau figure, and most wonderful hat pins. These are very elegant jewels that don't get worn so much today.
Well, provenance and context were everything in this situation, really, because there was no signatures that I can remember on the jewellery itself, and it was only the family history that identified the maker and her intentions. And now if it's blown apart and sold separately, that just goes to the four winds.
I mean, it's absolutely exceptional work. It's very inspired. And I think as a group of objects, I think you've got to think of about £25,000 to £30,000.
Good grief.
I hope, really in my heart, that that collection will find its way to a museum, because its dispersal would be too awful to contemplate.
Now, you wait around all day for a turner, and then two turn up at the same time.
This is a mezzotint after the great man, Joseph Mallord William Turner.
Yeah.
And it's by his namesake, but no relative, Charles Turner, mm-hmm. isn't it?
Yes.
Tell me, how did you get it?
Well, it came to my wife, whose grandfather was a descendant of Turner.
Oh, I see.
And
straight through the family?
Yes.
Fantastic. The owner of it was descended directly from Turner, the painter. And so it began to all add up into a really precious object. The two Turners had a very unique relationship. They worked very much together. They were fellow students at the Royal Academy. And Turner would go out and he'd search for views that would look well in engraving. Mm-hmm. And together they'd publish them and money was made.
Right.
Yeah.
And we believe that some of the little pencil scribbles on it are by Turner himself.
I saw the pencil marks. You can see them up here in the hills. It was quite clear that somebody had drawn on it in pencil and there was lots of marks on it. And somebody was trying to get that mezzotint looking right. Now, the question is, who? Now, if it had been Charles Turner, the mezzotinter himself, well, perhaps that would have been just a little less interesting. But if it's Joseph Mallord William Turner himself, the great man, then the whole thing begins to mean something. I love the idea that Charles Turner has produced the print to this stage and mm-hmm. then he's taken a pull and he's shown it to Joseph Mallord William Turner
yeah.
and said, what do you think? And he said, well, I think we could do with some more trees up here. And you see those pencil marks.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
and from behind this castle, just the very top of it, he's added a turret, all to make it more picturesque, mm-hmm. to make it more sublime, to give it that God-given light that it appears to have. But it's a really, really beautiful thing. I may be going out on a limb somewhat, but it's going to be worth up to about £8,000.
Blimey. Good Lord.
I doubt anyone who really had any great outside interest in Turner had ever seen this thing before now. And so for me to see it for the first time, what a thrill.
And in the same year, Graham Lay was also thrilled to intercept a forgotten national relic.
It had been an incredibly busy day, as it is very often on roadshow days, and I was feeling quite exhausted. And somebody came up with a wrought iron handle.
Before we went to the Antiques Roadshow, it was going down to the Imperial War Museum, London, to mark the 90th anniversary of the end of the Great War. And Merrick saw the advert in the paper. And of course, I then had to ring the Imperial War Museum and say, hang on a minute, you can't have it yet, because we're taking it on the Antiques Roadshow first.
Well, you've brought along today a piece of ironwork, which is not something I normally see in Militaria. So tell me, what's the story behind it?
It's one of the handles, the pattern that was made for the coffin of the Unknown Warrior in Westminster Abbey.
What an astonishing thing. And what's the relevance to you?
The company, founded by my grandfather, was commissioned to do the 8 handles and the straps on the coffin.
The grave of the Unknown Warrior was incredibly important in our military history. Up until 1920, if you were killed on a battlefield, you were more or less buried there, and nobody knew who you were. There was no focus for the bereaved families to express their terrible sorrow. And so the grave of the Unknown Warrior was placed in Westminster Abbey in order to give that focus. Now look, this is dated 1st of November 1920.
Yes.
Now, that's just 10 days before the ceremony.
Yes.
Well, that's astonishing.
Well, he worked, apparently wanted to receive the commission for 2 days and nights with no sleep.
Again, there's another side to the story. The ironwork had already been created for the coffin, and 7 days before the ceremony, they decided that it wasn't up to the required standard. So then they asked my grandfather to do the handles and the straps, which was done in that short time. And so because of that, records were lost as to who actually did the ironwork. So when you informed the Westminster Abbey what we had in our possession,
they
had no idea it existed.
I have to say, I am truly, truly privileged to see these, and I think anybody watching will be privileged too. You know, normally on the roadshow, of course, at this point, we talk about value.
Mm-hmm.
To be very honest, I really would rather not in this case, because I think something like this is beyond value.
Prior to 2006,
yes.
It was languishing in a drawer in the works, and we would show it to
gathering
people
dust.
If and when they wanted to see it. But since it's come out into the open, the respect it gets now, it's made me feel very, very proud and also a bit humble. Really, really pleased.
After appearing on the Antiques Roadshow, those pieces went on display in the Imperial War Museum in London and are now in the Royal Welsh Fusiliers Museum in Carnarvon. Before we go, just time for a revelation from roadshow expert Paul Atterbury. Regular viewers will recall that whatever he doesn't know about trains probably isn't worth asking. So here he is revealing the lifelong passion which took root when he was still in short trousers.
I think we all start collecting at some point as children. But my first collection is not really objects, it's memories. I was that classic small boy train spotter. I spent hours on windy platforms writing down train numbers, which now seems totally pointless, but it was so exciting. Standing on that platform, watching these expresses thundering through. And of course, locomotives have numbers which come in classes. And so you're driven to think, God, can I get that last one? I must see that last one to complete the class. And you never do, of course, because you can't cheat. You've got to see them absolutely in reality and then write it down. And you write it in your book, your Ian Allen spotter's book. And what you do is you tick them off, you underline them. And I look at this book now, which I've still got, and it brings it all back. I can see that eight-year-old dedicated and driven by the knowledge that this represents. It's what started me as a collector. But it's not the end of railways. I still love railways, I love writing about them, I love travelling on them. I'm not a railway collector, but there is one thing I had to have when it came up for sale earlier this year, and that is this nameplate, this totem from a station. I have it because this is the station on which I did my spotting, or one of the stations. And I like to think I might have stood, aged 8 or 10, beneath this very sign.
I can just picture that scene. And we'll have plenty more memorable moments conjured up for you in our next instalment of Priceless Antiques Roadshow.
BBC Two gets a backstage pass to go behind the scenes at the Barbican to watch Peter Brook rehearsing his latest production on The Culture Show next.